So hello and welcome. I'm Diana Hernandez. I am an assistant professor in the School of Public Health here at Columbia. I always like to say that I'm a sociologist by training, but generally very curious. Tonight, we are actually going to be talking about one of my favorite topics ever, which is energy insecurity. And I'm almost certain that you really haven't heard the term, but by the end of tonight, I hope that you'll really appreciate it for its importance, not only as a social problem, but also as a public health problem. But we are accompanied by panelists who are really working on solutions at different levels in philanthropy, in government, in nonprofits, and through corporate partnerships. And so we're really excited to be able to not only talk about the issues, but also talk about the solutions. Let me first quickly say that this event, this is all like the housekeeping stuff, so I have to kind of say this, is hosted by and sponsored by the Center for Global Energy Policy here at SEPA. And it's being webcast live. And both the full video and the podcast recording will be available on the center's website and on iTunes in coming days. And we'll send a follow-up with that information. For those of you watching online, as well as the people here in the audience, you can ask a question to the panelists at any time if you're on Twitter using the hashtag CGEPEvents at the Twitter handle at ColumbiaUEnergy. And I'm going to take a moment to just introduce the panelists by kind of very briefly. And because their bios are too long to actually go through in total. But Dana Borland is the Vice President of the Environment Program at the JPB Foundation. And in full disclosure, I am a JPB Environmental Fellow, which is affiliated with the Harvard School of Public Health. And they have been incredibly supportive of 12 fellows in total. And so I'm one of the beneficiaries. But Dana, in her role as the Vice President of the Environment Program at the JPB Foundation, works on issues at the intersection of health, poverty, and the environment. She's currently funding efforts in low-income communities related to increasing access to nature, supporting a clean and just energy transition, and detoxifying the built environment. Before joining the JPB Foundation, Dana was the Vice President of Green Initiatives for the Enterprise Community Partners, where she led an environmental strategy for this national organization, known for affordable housing development. While she was there, she basically developed and oversaw all aspects of the Enterprise's award-winning Green Communities program, including the creation of the Green Communities criteria, and the retrofit program for Enterprise. And this has actually become the standard in affordable housing development and is used basically as a kind of a parallel to LEED certification for affordable housing. She is trained, she's actually a certified planner and has a master's degree from Harvard's School of Business, right? In real estate. Welcome, Dana. We have another Dana. She's Dana Harmon. She actually is coming from Texas. She is the executive director of the Texas Energy Poverty Research Institute. And she is a leader in energy and consumer products. She had previously been in the oil and gas industry, but as the executive director of TEPRI, which is the acronym for the Texas Energy Poverty Research Institute, she oversees the overall strategic and operational aspects of the organization. And TEPRI has a mission to collect actionable data that industry partners can actually use to mitigate energy costs for low-income consumers across Texas. And today she actually will be talking a lot about the kind of partnerships that have been created, particularly with the utility companies throughout Texas. And then if I read just this portion of this sentence, it would actually apply to me as well. So Daphne is born and raised New Yorker, working in the energy efficiency industry. So she's a fellow Latina who's working in this space, really proud of her. She's worn many hats, and kind of managed a variety of environmental projects, such as greenhouse gas accounting for the United Nations, greening the blue, green jobs, green New York, and economic development and growth extension program for NYSERDA. And she's also managed a Superfund site in Newton Creek partnership coordination for U.S. Congresswoman Nydia Velasquez. Today, she's also worked with Solar One, coordinating energy efficiency opportunities for affordable housing and immigrant communities. Today, she's actually working with the city, or she's working with ICF International on a project in partnership with New York City Clean Heat and New York City's Retrofit Accelerator. So she'll be representing the government perspective. So, welcome panelists. It should be a really rich discussion given the kind of breadth and range of your areas. Again, for those of you who are watching online and listening to this podcast, my name is Diana Hernandez, and I'm here with Dana Borland, Vice President of Environment at JPB Foundation, Dana Harmon, Executive Director of the Texas Energy Poverty Research Institute, and Daphne Sanchez, Efficiency Advisor at the New York City Retrofit Accelerator. We are going to have a conversation about energy insecurity, and we invite you to ask questions, make comments, shout us out with the hashtag CGEP events at the Twitter handle Columbia U Energy. So I have the privilege of starting the show. And I have to say that speaking to Dana Harmon today, I realize this has been almost a decade-long journey for me personally. And this is, in many ways, a local story with global relevance. And I often refer to some headlines, right? So in some ways, this is around us. It's hidden in plain sight, the real issue of energy insecurity. And yet, it's something that we hardly pay attention to for some odd reason. And so bringing it back to the Bronx, which is where I actually grew up and live, there was a story back in 2013 about a fatal Bronx blaze that killed three children, and the cause of it was candles. If you just read the headline, you would say, oh my goodness, these people left the candles on, and it just, the candle fell and caused a fire. But looking at the details of that story, it actually turns out that the family had their lights shut off, and that to create light or to have light in their homes, they were using candles. And then the candles caused a fire. But the real issue wasn't the candles, it was actually the shutoff. This winter has been kind of uncharacteristically warm, but oftentimes we see headlines about households that don't have heat, where the tenants are really complaining, like this one, and that their temper is the only thing heating up. There was an interesting special this past summer about NYCHA, so the New York City Housing Authority, and residents, where one in two households in NYCHA actually live without an AC. And they have to debate whether or not a fan or the windows open or closed creates cooler environments in their homes. And in NYCHA, residents aren't actually expected to pay for the utilities, so they don't have to pay the electric bills, right? So that's kind of one barrier that's reduced. But there are some upfront costs, A, the cost of the unit, B, the cost of professional installation of the unit, and then an additional fee per AC unit. These are enough of a barrier to actually create opportunities for overheating in homes. It's fair to say that energy is really a basic need, and the World Health Organization recognizes that energy is essential to meeting our basic needs, cooking, boiling water, lighting, and heating. It's also a prerequisite for good health, they say, a reality that has largely been ignored by the world community. So I am going to go over just a few details about energy burden in the U.S., and basically make a parallel to food insecurity, which is a term that is more commonly understood or known. And there is about an equal number of households, about 16 million households in the U.S. that are impacted by energy insecurity. Race, ethnicity, and immigration status matter, as do children, as do households with vulnerable members, so children and the elderly. Renters are more likely to experience energy insecurity than our owners, although that depends on some of the kind of local dynamics. Energy efficiency and really the lack thereof is really contributing to higher costs. There are geographic disparities, so that in the South, there are households are more likely to experience energy burden. And in metropolitan areas like Memphis, they're actually more likely to experience energy insecurity. And overall, this is really a hidden source of hardship. It's also related to the housing stock, so that lower income families are more likely than their higher income counterparts to experience housing with heating and electrical problems, have experienced multiple heating equipment breakdowns, an interruption in utility service, have inadequate insulation and insufficient heating capacity. And they're also more likely to report being uncomfortably cold for 24 hours or more in the winter. So simply put, poor people are paying more for less. And I will spare the details on this because in my overview, I did go over the fact that that there are particular households that are experiencing this. And I will basically end my comments where this story actually begins for me. There was a woman in my dissertation research. I call her Merle. And she really helped me to see this issue. I hadn't necessarily, I was like studying housing and its impacts on health, and I was expecting mold and overcrowding, and that was the issue that I went out, you know, to understand. And then it was Merle, who was a Section 8 recipient and a woman who was bouncing around apartment by apartment, experiencing all kinds of issues in her energy experience. And this quote in some ways starts and finishes my, or at least, you know, really started my curiosities. She said, "My apartment was huge, but it was awful too because of the heating system. That's where my gas bill started to become so high. The heat would always go out. The furnace or whatever it took to control the heat would fail. The heat would be on and it would shut off and it would be on again. It was never constant, consistent heat. It was cold in our kitchen and a lot of our bedrooms were cold. So that basically was the start of my high gas bill because I had to keep running that senseless heat." That's the problem. We're really fortunate to be hearing about solutions. And so with that, I'd like to turn over the mic to Dana Borland from the JPB Foundation, who will be talking about her efforts on the national level to fund and to problem solve. Dana.
Should I come up there? Sure. Great. Well, good evening, everybody. It's terrific to be here. Thanks, Diana, for the invitation and panelists. It's great to be among women in energy. That rarely happens still. So it's great to be on a panel with only women. And I should say I give some thanks to people I work with, at Lauren Ross at AC Triple E, Ann Evans, president of Elevate Energy. Both of them helped provide me some comments in my remarks today, and they've been instrumental too in the work that we're funding. But before I get too carried away, because sometimes I miss the punchline when I have PowerPoint, I just wanted to say up front that our current energy system indisputably is disproportionately impacting poor people. And all of us in the room and streaming and out there online, if we're engaged in this transition to a clean energy future, it's our responsibility to make sure that we enable a just and equitable transition, both the process and where we end up. So I just, would start off with that call of action. I think I'm in the room with those who have already taken up the call or the oath to do this. But, especially in this day and age, in this political climate, I would be remiss not to underscore just how important this is and how our energy system today is burdening the poor. So as I would sort of think about the energy system, I have a planning background. And I kind of cobbled this diagram together of, the coal production, how it gets turned into electricity and ends up in our home, and what it does, to get to the plug so we can actually use electricity. And to me, this is just a picture of, like, waste, obsolescence, and pollution. And if you follow this around the whole system, you also know that the context of our energy system, who's living near the coal plant? Who's living next to the stream that's got the waste in it from the coal plant? Who's living by the transmission lines, the incinerators? Who's living in that leaky house? We know that it's people in poverty, with millions paying more than 10% of their income just for electricity. And they're, we're wasting it and polluting our way to get it to the plug, and we're still disproportionately burdening poor people who feel the burden of paying for this important necessity, really, in this day and age. So I, as Diana said, I in 2004 had the opportunity to really think about ways to use housing as a platform to transform that sector so that we were providing housing that was healthier and more efficient and was actually responsive to our environment. And so that was the Green Communities Program at Enterprise Community Partners, where we were aware of sort of what was happening in the green building sector. And we wanted to bring those benefits to the affordable housing community, which oftentimes when we start programs, when we're entering new spaces, we sort of carve out affordable housing to kind of figure it out on its own. And we don't include it in our solutions because it's complicated, the financing is structured strange, and it's oftentimes just too difficult to figure out, too many actors. And we go after the big buildings, the sort of easy to understand sectors. And this was happening again in 2004. We had the U.S. Green Building Council doing an amazing job across the world igniting our thinking around designing buildings to be green. And we wanted to bring those benefits to the affordable housing community. And so that's what Green Communities set out to do. And as Diana mentioned, we did create a holistic framework for thinking about that. So it wasn't just that we were trying to, address energy. We wanted to address water. We wanted to address the context of where the housing was being developed or how it was being renovated, so that we were really providing these measurable health and economic benefits. And so that's what the criteria set out to do. And it still exists today, and it really is one of the driving frameworks for delivering affordable housing, particularly in the affordable multifamily housing space. But my takeaway from almost a decade of working on green communities was something called integrated design. And it was really a very simple idea that you sit down with a sort of cross-disciplinary team before you even take the first step of designing how you wanted to renovate or build new green affordable housing. And it was called integrated design. And what I'm realizing, well, what I realized then was that was how you kept costs down, and that's how you address multiple things together seamlessly in a way where you, for less money, got more benefits and better outcomes. We're not doing that in the energy space. I'm not seeing integrated design when we think about how we're retrofitting our buildings. And so I just wanted to throw that out there as a thought, too, that there are some lessons from the green building world that we can, that we still haven't mastered, that we're still forgetting to do, and integrated design is definitely one of them. And in our efforts at Enterprise, we were learning. The other takeaway for me working on Enterprise Green Communities was the real stories that I got to listen in on from people living in housing that had either been renovated to be green or was built new to be green. And primarily, the best outcomes were actually around sort of the energy improvements through the green communities criteria. And we did lots of health studies as we were trying to measure the benefits of green. And one of the things I think that you touched on, Diana, is in this country right now, there's 25 million people at least that suffer from asthma. And that means that there's 2 million emergency room visits, over 500,000 hospitalizations from asthma. And when I was going around meeting some of the people living in our green communities housing, that was the thing that stood out the most for me, is that dramatically, sometimes within weeks and months, kids who had suffered their whole life from asthma were no longer having symptoms. And one in particular was a development in Worthington, Minnesota. And the mom was traveling an hour once a month to go to and then an hour back from the clinic so that her daughter could get the medical care she needed for asthma. But within 6 months of living in a renovated home, she was no longer having symptoms of asthma. And I could tell you story after story of this. And Diana touched on the reasons why, because the renovation addressed energy issues, but really those were health issues. So cold air infiltration and leaky windows and all sorts of system failures was leading this young woman and many, many, many thousands of others of kids who are living in housing that's energy insecure, but it's impacting their health as well. And so, you know, these are some of the multiple benefits of energy efficiency for low-income households. And, you know, a personal story, I actually grew up in England, and I had a brother who had asthma. And we had an old stove. It was an auger. Has anyone heard of an auger? It was this great big orange, there one person has, stove. And I have three brothers, so I didn't have to go out to this as big container of coal that my brothers had to get the coal and bring it into the home so that my mom and dad could use the stove to feed and warm us. And I'm positive that my brother was his asthma was triggered because of his daily, sometimes twice a day, having to go into this bin of coal so that we could heat the auger stove with it. And when we moved, and we moved quite a bit, his asthma went away, and he became quite a remarkable athlete, actually, later in his high school and college career. But it just, you know, these are real issues that I've experienced personally, I've seen up close. And so when I came to JPB to start the environment program, I was really interested in continuing this work and bringing the philanthropic support to address these issues. And so this study here is one that just came out from ACEEE, and Lauren Ross, who I mentioned in the beginning, was one of the lead authors of it, to measure low-income energy burden, which is the percent of the household income that you spend on your energy bills. The low-income households spend a greater portion of their income on utilities than the average family, as you can see. And there is a racial lens to this. Black families, families of color, spend even more disproportionately for their energy. And if you spend more for energy, you are spending less on something else. And there was an early study, there have been many studies on this, that if you look at household, you sort of average household income earners and low-income household earners, if they're living in a place where it gets cold in the winter, they will pay more, if they can, to heat their house. But it's been proven that they, if you come from a poor family, you will spend less on food, whereas an average income household would continue to spend what they did, or even more in the winter, on food. So these issues are inextricably combined. Housing security, food security, energy security, they're all related. So this study was measuring the burden, the energy burden of low-income households. And as you can see in the lower dots of those metropolitan areas, is sort of the average energy burden for a household. And the blue dots show then the energy burden for low-income households. And on the far left, what's interesting is Memphis has the highest energy burden. Memphis, you would think, rather temperate, probably not so burdened when it comes to energy costs. But that just goes to show that it's not just about the price of electricity. It's about the home. It's about so many other things that lead to high energy burdens. And so the other point I wanted to make here, sort of on the so what, is also that as we think of the energy burden, if you're able to, you're going to try and move to keep your housing costs down, to keep your energy costs down. So as we have sort of a rental crisis in this country with 7.4 million households who are housing insecure and can't find affordable rental housing, these issues become exacerbated. So if you can't pay your electricity bill, you may end up getting evicted. And then you're going to go to housing that's probably even worse. So we're on a downward spiral. So all of this to say, really, that where this slide shows, we do a terrible job, actually, but we do have some programs to help households pay their electricity bills. That could be in the form of ratepayer assistance funds or weatherization funds or low-income housing and energy LIHEAP funds. There we go. But what we need to do, as you can see the piece of the pie that's circled there, we need to grow that slice of the pie so that we're actually paying for retrofits. We're paying for energy efficiency improvements rather than sort of a convoluted pass-through through the ratepayer assistance so that you can pay your bill back to the utility. We need to be encouraging more energy efficiency programs that are addressed and targeted to owners and renters of affordable housing. And that's what we've been trying to do at JPB, is to really incent utilities to have programs that are directed to the affordable multifamily sector. And so we asked ourselves, what's happening in this space? And what we found was that they're not getting a fair share. So we all pay into the ratepayer assistance funds. It's part of your utility bill. But the people living in rental housing, in multifamily affordable housing, they are not getting their fair share of those dollars to make deep or even moderate energy efficiency improvements. So they're probably not getting the bill assistance that they need because those programs are underfunded. And then they're also not being able to take advantage of utility programs that they're actually paying into, but they're not getting the money back to retrofit their housing. And so we really wanted to address this. And we launched a program called Energy Efficiency for All. And the intent of this was to get a fair share of our dollars from utility programs into affordable multifamily housing. And these are the partners, not your typical bedfellows, NRDC, the National Housing Trust, and the Energy Foundation, and Elevate Energy came together, all with different sources of expertise, and set out to get a fair share. And in 3 years, they wanted that to equate to $180 million in new funding in the 8 states where they were working. And they were wildly successful. They have actually secured $208 million, which just goes to show that we can influence these programs. The utilities are hungry for these kind of solutions. It's in their best interest. And even though this particular program was trying to get ahead of the Clean Power Plan, because we knew if there was a Clean Power Plan and states had to implement that plan, they were going to do what we've always do, push affordable housing to the side, not see its relevance in aggregation and its impact on our utility system, and focus on the sort of easy to do. And so we wanted to launch energy efficiency for all to say, look, affordable housing is part of the solution, and here's a great way to design your programs and make it work. And so that's what they've been doing, is trying to help rewrite the programs. And in those states where they're working, they have been successful. And the role of the Energy Foundation, they play many roles, but one of them is they've been helping to build out, along with their other partners, a network of energy and water and health affordable building professionals and practitioners. It's called the NewHab Network. And you can get to it through the energyefficiencyforall.org website. But the NewHab, that network of energy and housing professionals and practitioners and low-income housing groups and environmental justice groups, they're the ones working and creating their own tables in these states to come together and design these programs and design them in ways that will work for them, that will be environmentally just and will provide energy security. So I'd like to end there, but really, you know, what is it all about is the people. And just looking at all the notes that I didn't look at earlier, but you know, it comes down to addressing energy security in a way that works for poor people. And and we have to do this in an integrative way, so that we're not just showing up on their doorstep to change their light bulbs or to address a leaky faucet. But we need to think about the entire home. We need to think about the structure. Is the roof okay? Is there radon? Are the appliances working? What's going on with the carpet? And really, you know, think about the home in a holistic manner. And when we do that through this program that JPB supports called the Green and Healthy Homes Initiative, we actually save money. So if you can take energy efficiency dollars, healthy housing dollars, and other streams of funding and braid them to work together, you can go into a home and make all those improvements at one time and save money. This particular project highlights the fact that the cost for the Green and Healthy Homes renovations, which did look at all of those things I mentioned, would cost about $6,000. If they had done them separately, if they had come sort of separately to address energy and come back the next day to address the roof and come back, you know, months, years later to do something else, it would have cost more than $8,000. So there was a savings for doing these things all together. And at the end of the day, the single parent homeowner, Ms. Ramirez, she has 3 children. One of them had severe asthma, the youngest. And her son had to be hospitalized 3 times, sent to the ER 3 times in a year prior to the Green and Healthy Homes intervention. And as is many the case, the child missed 14 days of school, which is sort of an average missed days of schools if you have asthma. And the caregiver also usually misses at least 10 work days a year, which you can imagine might mean that you lose your job to help your child. And this was the case here as well. Ms. Ramirez missed also 14 days of work. But through the intervention where they addressed issues that are triggers for asthma, her son was no longer experiencing the asthma, not having to go to the hospital, and the mom was able to go to work. It's a terrific story, and there's so many more of them. So we do know how to help households gain energy security and housing security and health security. And and food security. And so, you know, again, I would just urge us all to think about these things holistically, to not take the easy route. You know, if you, what's the saying, you can give someone a fish, they'll eat for a day, teach them how to fish, you know, they'll eat forever. That's the same thing here. Let's not pay someone's energy bill. Let's figure out a much better solution to our energy system and provide energy security and not keep disproportionately burdening the poor. Thank you.
And now we'll hear from Dana Hartman, who will take us to Texas in her talk.
Good evening, everyone. Hello. Thank you for having me. Thank you, Diana. And wow, it's so cool to be with like-minded people up here and to really focus this discussion. You know, in Texas, of course, our perspective is quite different. And that's one of the things that Diana asked us to talk about. But it's really interesting to hear so much focus being placed on these issues. And thank you. Thank you all for joining. First of all, the Texas perspective is that it's cold here. got off the plane today and was a little bit shocked. I was in flip-flops yesterday. No, really, I just wanted to talk a little bit about the work that we're doing at the Texas Energy Poverty Research Institute. We are a collaboration of power market participants focused on inspiring lasting energy solutions for low-income communities. If you hadn't heard of us, that's not a huge surprise. We are a startup, a nonprofit in Texas. We're less than a year old at this point, but we do have good momentum. And I think what we'd like to be able to do is build on some of the momentum that's already created here to look at solutions in our part of the country as well, and also share knowledge and best practices so that we can collectively make an impact on energy burdens across the country. Our members are utilities, both regulated and deregulated in Texas. Our market is a little bit unique, as well as community action agencies, affordable housing providers, service providers, all looking at ways to reduce energy burdens. When you think of Texas, we are an energy state. Most people think of, you know, big oil and gas production. We're also the largest wind producer in the country, which is not necessarily well known. The grid is managed by ERCOT, which covers 90% of the load in Texas. 75% of that is competitive choice. The Texas legislature deregulated the market in 2002. And what that means is the transmission and distribution utilities, the poles and wires, are still regulated, but both the generation and the retail sales of electricity are deregulated in the competitive market. So that actually presents some interesting challenge when we're looking at utilities dealing with in their place in energy burdens. This is a little bit of a complex slide, but if you'll bear with me, I'd like to try to explain my thinking here because I think it tells an interesting story. There on, let's see, on the left side is the population in Texas. So we're home to three of the top 10 largest cities in the country with Houston, Dallas, and San Antonio. And it's a huge state. In fact, the dark green areas there are the population centers. And to get from Dallas to Houston takes about as long as it does to get from here to Washington, D.C., if we're looking at perspective. Also, the slide in the middle there, the map in the middle there shows poverty trends in Texas. And what's important to notice there is that our poverty trends don't necessarily match our population centers. A lot of the poverty we experience is along the border. At the Texas-Mexico border in South Texas and then out in West Texas. Here you can see it also, this is actually by census tract, not just by county, so that you can see we do have our share of poverty in cities. However, that's a very different situation. So a rural area down along the border, likely single family housing, likely high occupancy is very different than multifamily housing in the city. And we want to look at solutions to address all these scenarios. All of these have significant effects on energy consumption patterns for the consumers, for the households. The third slide, or the third map there, shows a little bit about our electricity market. I mentioned that we were deregulated. So the shaded areas show the transmission and distribution utilities, the poles and wires companies that I mentioned. The retail services are provided by retail electric companies. There are about 200 in the state. And then the non-shaded areas are covered by municipal utilities, co-ops, and integrated utilities. So, and there's another map here that I didn't show, and that's climate zones. So in Texas, because of the size of our state, we actually have three different climate zones. So down in Houston, it's very hot, muggy in the summer, which is very different than up in Amarillo, where it can get quite cold, actually, in the wintertime, which is different than West Texas in the desert. So the reason that I wanted to show these slides is if you can imagine overlaying each of those maps, you would have a pretty complex picture as you're trying to address energy poverty. But what we'd like to be able to do is, if you can imagine creating fingerprints for each of these regions of low-income pockets, looking at the geography, looking at the housing type, the cultural structure, as well as the electricity market structure, you can start to create trends, and we can look at that and then what's working in other parts of the country, perhaps a on-bill financing program in North Carolina that might apply, or something in New York that could apply in one of our more dense areas. You can start to see how we could spread best practices and start to address some of our energy burdens. Next, I'd like to talk a little bit about the colonias in South Texas. These are informal communities along the border, that red highlighted section that I showed in the last slide. There was a study done in 2013 by the University of Texas and an organization called Power Across Texas, which was actually a predecessor to TEPRI, to our organization, looking at electricity accessibility and affordability in the colonias. When I say an informal community, these are settlements that are created without infrastructure, so without basic sewer, water, or electricity, often without roads. A famous example would be the favelas in Rio de Janeiro, which are much more dense than the colonias, but kind of a similar pattern of evolution. There are about 400,000 residents, 400,000 Texans in the colonias, in 3,000 communities. 98% Hispanic population here, very high poverty. The household size is about 4.3 people per house. Compare that to the U.S., which is about 2.6. And it's a lot of children and elderly in these houses. The average income is about $1,600 a month, or about $19,000 a year, underscoring the poverty status and high hunger in the area. There are many issues to be addressed in the colonias, but for the purpose of this discussion and really our work, we're looking at energy and energy security. Really, the result of this study was that solutions, in order to be successful to addressing energy insecurity in the colonias, must be able to account for low and irregular income, little home equity, poor credit history, long-term home ownership horizons, and also understanding that these residents can't afford high upfront costs or even be expected to meet regularly scheduled payments. This is just a little bit of a view of what a solution would have to be tailored toward for those communities. Unfortunately, the problem in Texas is expected to grow. As Dana mentioned, LIHEAP funding is potentially being cut in the president's new budget. And even now, LIHEAP, which is the federal program for energy assistance and weatherization, is only covering about 2% of the eligible population in Texas. There's a state program that we've had called Light Up Texas, which was put in place when the market restructured in 2002, called Light Up Texas, which has been decommissioned. The summer of 2017 will be the first summer that funding is no longer available. And as I mentioned, we have a summer peak, and so that's when we get hit the hardest. And this is all happening as the population is growing. Right now, about 26% of Texas Hispanics are living in poverty, and the Hispanic population is expected to double by 2050. So we need to address these, and we need to not count on federal or state funding in order to do it. So we're coming together looking for solutions. I won't go into energy burdens too much because we've talked about it a decent amount already, but the one thing that I do want to point out here is even at different poverty levels, energy burdens aren't created equal. So it probably doesn't come as a surprise, but basically the poorer you are, the harder you're hit. And so we need to take that into account as we're looking at this group collectively. The other thing worth mentioning is that low-income households in Texas, and I suspect elsewhere, tend to have flat load consumption profiles. A lot of that has to do with the poor quality housing stock and lack of energy efficiency initiatives that Dana mentioned. Here is a concept that we've been working on at the Institute that's basically trying to say, okay, this is a complicated picture. How do we start to address it? And really what this is at the center, if you look at energy poverty or energy insecurity, the first order there are kind of, let's say, first order issues or those things that are very directly related to energy insecurity. The second order are also related, the second level there are also related and issues we'd like to address but perhaps have a less direct impact but are worth understanding. As you're going from one side of the picture, on the left side, you're looking more at energy, industry, and utility factors. And as you come to the other side, you're looking at quality of life and people. And really, I think what we want to tell with this story is that this is all connected. This is all very tightly woven when we're looking at energy poverty and housing, energy and health, energy and technology equitability. And we'd really like to be able to understand the relationships among them all. One of the things that we're doing at the Institute is working on an energy poverty clearinghouse. With this, it was one of our initial projects, and we're working on basically doing a literature review of all of the studies that are out there, the good work done by Diana, by ACEEE, and by others in the industry to say, what do we know now? Make sure that we're making that information available to utilities and to other members of the industry. And what do we need to know? Where are the gaps? And we're actually about to release a white paper on these findings in the next couple of weeks, and we're excited to have a portal available for this research as a tool that we hope to launch this summer. So here we're just trying to say to show a little bit about the role that we as an institute hope to play in this picture. So number one, we'd like to educate both consumers, but then also the industry. From the utility industry to the housing industry and to policymakers on energy and security issues. We want to facilitate discussions. So we want to bring together, as Dana mentioned, members of different expertise so that we can look at this more holistically and not just from the perspective of any one group. We'd like to be able to leverage funding. So one of the strengths of our model is as a consortium, we can bring together funding from several different sources to be able to focus on one study and leverage those dollars more than any one utility would be able to do themselves. We want to advance knowledge. This is definitely an understudied area. And you know, the fact events like these are, I think, very good for raising awareness, but there's still a lot that we don't know. And so that's what one of the things that we want to do as an organization, but ultimately the goal is to make an impact. We want to increase the quality of life for low-income communities through energy. And so as we're taking on our research, we're looking at those studies that have the greatest impact potential, either in the greatest number of kilowatt hours reduced, the greatest number of people reached, the greatest cost saved, or the greatest environmental impact. So this slide talks a little bit about what we're currently working on. The first, the Energy Poverty Clearinghouse, I mentioned, and that is underway. And as I said, we're excited to launch both the paper and the portal for our website. The second project that we are taking on is a Texas low-income profile report. And frankly, this one was a little bit of a surprise to me, but came out of one of our meetings with our research advisory committee, which is our members kind of directing our research topics. And what they said was basically they don't have a good understanding of their low-income consumers. So there's you know, some census data out there, but often really the only thing a utility may know is if somebody checks a box for federal assistance. But you may not know very much about the housing profile or the housing type, the demographics, how to communicate. And so this is one of the things that we're doing on a statewide level to try to better understand the demographics of our low-income consumers. We're excited to get this project started this hopefully this summer. We're almost there in terms of funding, but I think this can be a very impactful project. And then the third thing that we're working on are case studies. We want to, there is good work going on in Texas, and there's good work going on across the country. So we want to find, highlight, and promote models that are working. We're actually in discussions about two different solar projects, one in Waco and one in Austin. One is a community solar initiative with a local nonprofit there. And another was actually with Habitat for Humanity, about a solar project with Habitat. And we'd really like to understand sustainable business models that help with the technology equitability component, because a lot of solar is often not recognized by low-income communities, and then also what can last in the long term. We're very grateful for the support of our members, and here's a current listing of our members. Many of these are utilities in Texas, both regulated and deregulated, the transmission and distribution utilities I mentioned, the retail electric providers, municipal utilities, but then also we've got the Texas Association of Community Action Agencies bringing the community perspective, and we're starting to work closely with the Texas Department of the Texas Association of Community Development Corporations as well. And so as we've been discussing, it's very important to bring all of these perspectives to the table so that we can have a holistic view. Thank you for your time. I'm happy to take any questions. And,
So thank you to both Danas for wonderful presentations. And now we'll bring it local with Daphne Sanchez. And I just want to encourage you guys to prepare questions. So there will be an opportunity to ask questions of our panelists.
Hi, everyone. Sorry, I'm a little Good evening, everyone. I hope you guys have had a good, interesting week. So my name is Daphne Sanchez. Can you hear me better now? Good. I am an efficiency advisor with a New York City program called NYC Retrofit Accelerator. And thank you so much for having us today and giving us the opportunity to talk about our program and how we're working in New York City. So very quickly, the NYC Retrofit Accelerator program is a program that's offered through the Mayor's Office of Sustainability here at New York City. We are a free technical assistance program provided to all privately owned buildings in New York City. So affordable housing buildings, different types of residential buildings, commercial, industrial, so on and so forth. And the type of advisory service we provide is specifically on helping buildings understand what are their opportunities in doing energy efficiency upgrades, what are the resources that are out there that they can use, and as well, what are the contractors that are trained and educated and understand how to do the work holistically without negatively impacting the property. So the program actually stems from New York City's Plan NYC, and the legislations from the Greater Greener Buildings Plan really set foot for us to do the work that we're doing today. Specifically, the two legislations that that buildings have to comply with every couple of years. So Local 84 requires buildings now in 2018 that are 25,000 square feet and above to do benchmarking every year. It's basically where they tell the city the amount of water and electricity consumption they use. And then Local 87 requires buildings over 50,000 square feet to do energy audits and retrocommissioning. Retrocommissioning is just a small energy efficiency adjustments they have to do to their building to meet with code regulations. So those are the two legislations that we provide technical assistance to properties, and they actually come to us asking us how to comply, and we're like, well, you know, here's how you comply, but here's some other things you can do. And some background information on Retrofit Accelerator. Our program was actually known as NYC Clean Heat,
And the NYC Clean Heat Program stemmed from Local Law 43, which required buildings to convert off of number 6 heavy heating oil into a cleaner fuel. So as a city program, we are fuel neutral. So we were helping buildings convert to either ULS2, biodiesel, or natural gas. And so the reason why this is very important is because, as you can see in these two maps, is that the Clean Heat Program really saw something important. Not only is it important to reduce the greenhouse gas emissions, we also saw just how much air pollution was happening with these buildings that were burning number 6 heating oil. And as you can see, the transition from 2008 to 2012, when buildings really started acting, unfortunately, because it was a legislation that required them to do it, but they started converting, and you started seeing neighborhoods, especially low-income community neighborhoods, really acting up and doing the conversions and actually having cleaner air. And this was a study that was done on by the city's Department of Health, which they also talk a little bit more about the reduction of visitations to the hospital, which I thought was very important. So because of the success, and actually 1/3 of the city's buildings were assisted by the Clean Heat Program, and we had 100% compliance rate when number 6 heating oil was phased out in 2015, which is amazing for some of these buildings. I'm still in shock when I read that every time. So because of the success of the Clean Heat Program, the city realized more programs that provide technical assistance should be created to help buildings understand the resources, the process, the red tapes, the utilities, and help them go through it and make sure that they're able to do the projects and do energy efficiency work in a easy, non-vendor, non-pushing, non-selling way. So the city created 3 major programs: the Retrofit Accelerator, which I am a part of, and I'll talk a little bit later; the Community Retrofit NYC, which is a program specifically geared to smaller buildings in Central Brooklyn and Southern Queens, also known as the Con Edison BQDM zone, to help with their specific needs in reducing energy efficiency. And we also have the New York City Benchmarking Help Center, which is a program specifically catered to help buildings comply with Local Law 84. It educates them on how to use EPA's Portfolio Manager. It helps them understand how to submit their documentations or how to request for their utility usage from Con Edison and National Grid. So the NYC Retrofit Accelerator, what is it? A lot of people come to us and they ask us, do you do energy audits? You know, are you going to come in and switch my light bulbs? Are you going to fix my my boiler? It's leaking. And no, unfortunately, we don't do any of that. We don't duplicate. We don't do anything that the market already has. We're basically a building advisory service, a technical consultant for building operators, for property managers, for co-op boards, to understand in an unbiased manner what are the options they have. So we work one-on-one with building owners, of all ranges, of all understanding of buildings, to help them understand what are their energy efficiency needs. We also help them understand who are qualified contractors out there. We've had buildings come to us and say, hey, you know, ABZ contractor told us we should put this type of hydronic building boiler system, and they're steam boilers. They have a steam boiler system, which completely makes no sense. So we help them understand, you know, what is actually feasible for them. And we also always recommend them to call and contact the qualified engineers and contractors. In addition to that, we understand, especially I work exclusively in the affordable housing space in this program. So I understand that a lot of properties are cash, don't have a lot of cash in their reserves. They're very worried about regulations, and they're very worried about how much money they can spend on a boiler versus a tenant that needs a roof or a ceiling replacement, right? So we'll sit down with them, we'll go and we'll talk holistically about their capital needs as well as their energy efficiency needs, and provide them with a list of resources they can tap into. We also help connect directly to those resources. So we won't give them a 1-800 number or a website. We'll connect them directly to a program manager. In addition to that, once buildings start looking at the energy efficiency upgrades and opportunities that they can do, we'll make sure that they're training staff. If they are co-op and they are self-managed, we'll make sure that they're trained at no cost to understand what are the mechanical systems that are being implemented and put into their building so that they can operate it efficiently. Because it's great to have a new boiler system. It's great to have new lighting with sensors. But if your building operation staff are not comfortable using it, it's going to fall back and it's not going to be working as efficiently as it can. We will support, we will provide technical assistance from the beginning of an end, from the beginning to the end of a project. And our program is here for 10 years, so we will be around for a while helping these properties. So I wanted to give you guys I'm going to do two quick case studies of two buildings that are very dear to me because I've been working with them for a year and a half since our program launched. And this first building is in Brooklyn. They're a Mitchell Lama building. They're three buildings, affordable housing, that are managed by HCR, which is the New York State Housing Communities Development Renewal Agency. Sorry. They have 423 units. They're a total of three large buildings, 15 floors. And they had to comply with Local Law 87, which is the energy audit and retrocommissioning in 2014. So we met with this building through another city program called the Carbon Challenge. And they were interested in reducing their greenhouse gas reductions. They're interested in doing energy efficiency work. But they also want to get a new roof. And as you can see, these are large buildings. It's going to cost them a lot of money to do the work. And they didn't know where to start. So we went through their Local Law 87 report. We explained to them their options. We realized that there was an opportunity to do roof insulation. There was an opportunity to do some lighting work. And there were also other opportunities related to their water consumption. We went in, we helped them understand their property and their priorities. And we realized that this building was in a special zone called the Demand Management Zone from Con Edison's Brooklyn, Queens. Brooklyn, Queens Demand Management Zone. And because of this opportunity, they were able to do an entire lighting retrofit, all LED lights, in the entire complex for free. Is something that the utility offer, and it's something that the co-op board was not aware of. And this saved them thousands of dollars in a contractor, thousands of dollars for the materials, and in their utility bills right away. So these are and some opportunities that we spoke to them about it about as well. The other things that we spoke to them about was CHP. They had a concern that during Sandy, their lights went out. And having a combined heat and power, cogen, CHP, will give them the opportunity to continue operating common area lighting as well as one elevator. And this was critical to them because they had a lot of seniors in their building. So where we are today with this building is that they have actually submitted documentation to NYSERDA and Con Edison. They're doing a power purchase agreement, so they're getting 500 kilowatts CHP system at no cost since they're doing a PPA, and they are already working with a contractor on installing the equipment. So that's a large building in our project, and we've been working with that co-op board for a year and a half. It's senior citizens, so explaining the systems took 5 months, and then actually getting in a contractor to explain it in layman terms took another 2 months. But we are still working with them, and because of the lighting retrofit went so well, they have been able to open up and move forward with other efficiency projects. So on the opposite end of the spectrum, I have a tiny building, which is a cute monolingual. I love them because they're Puerto Rican and they have a whole bunch of Puerto Rican flags all over their building. So it was easy for me to relate to them being a half Puerto Rican. And they're a tiny building in the Lower East Side. They have 8 units. One property, 6 floors. They were affected by Sandy, so they lost their boiler system. They were struggling to, a contractor had came and did some kind of short-term fix to their boiler, and the boiler was still not working. They have a hydronic building. They had some concerns about the implementation costs once again. Being in a neighborhood that's quickly gentrifying, they wanted to preserve their affordability. And so we spoke with them. We talked about different types of options being an affordable housing development, the resiliency options that actually Enterprise Community Partners provides to multifamily buildings in New York City, and their energy efficiency needs because their utility bills are really high. So they actually, we gave them all the opportunities, and they actually decided to go forward with a New York City agency program, which is HPD, Housing Preservation Development. They actually have a green housing preservation program, which is brand new. They are providing a 0% interest loan to this property to do a combination of work. So they're going to be doing some boiler work. They're also doing a solar on there. They want to do a solar green roof, but the board the board is having some discussions on that piece. But they have completed their audit, and they feel more empowered knowing what are the actual things. They had ideas of what the issues were, but now they know what the actual issues are, and they are very adamant in getting these things done. So now where we are in 2017, I'm still working with this board. We have not done any work, but the co-op is talking to different contractors, going around with their audit and telling them, hey, this is what I need. I know what I want. And we're helping them understand how to prioritize all of the projects in a reasonable manner with the funds that HPD is giving to us. And so, yeah, so I, once again, Retrofit Accelerator, we're providing the free technical assistance. I exclusively work in the affordable housing space, and we work very closely ensuring that properties have all the information, all the resources that they need to make an insightful decision. Thank you.
So we have about, 15 minutes. 20 minutes. Okay, good. And I want to take the privilege of the moderator or the moderator's privilege to ask just one question per person and then expect short responses. All right. So the question for you, Dana, you mentioned something about integrated energy systems. And I just want you to like take a second to think about what that would look like while I pose another question to Dana. And that's about the benefits of ratepayers. So what we can do in roundup programs, right? So when you get your energy bill, there's like, oh, you know, you can help low-income families if you give an extra dollar or whatever. If you can discuss anything that you know about kind of the benefits of these roundup programs and what they've been able to do. And then Daphne, I'm going to ask you a more depressing question about issues in like the time frame to completion. So obviously for lower income households, I mean, part of it is the need for these things, but also the kind of the urgency and what that means for the projects that you're now managing because they are kind of they seem like they are taking a bit of time. And so those are the questions. Go.
Right. I'll be really short because I want to hear other questions too. So that what I was referencing in terms of integrated energy systems was more about the design principle behind how we approach retrofitting housing and to think about it holistically. So that oftentimes we get some kind of incentive. Maybe it's a lighting incentive or it's a boiler replacement program, and we just do that. But if we can figure out how to take a step back and look at the whole home or the whole building and design our improvements based on that, we'll actually, it will cost less to do all of that work together at one time, and we will get more benefit from it. So that's really, you know, it's sort of regardless of what energy system you may need, it's more a design thinking as we approach energy retrofits to step back and take an integrated, holistic approach.
Regarding the utility roundup programs, there are several in Texas, and I've actually had conversations with several different utilities about the success of those programs. And you know, from my experience, what I've heard is actually the subscription rates are relatively low, unfortunately. And I, you know, my feeling there is that it's not because of a lack of desire. It's more kind of a lack of awareness. I think we as an industry probably aren't doing a good enough job communicating that our neighbors are having these struggles. You know, I think in our communities at least, you know, I think that the people really don't know. And so I think, you know, especially with what we've discussed about federal and state funding drying up, I think that is a very innovative solution, but I think we need to be creative in how utilities need to be creative in how they reach out to their customers and get engagement for roundup programs or other fundraising programs. And also just, you know, mentioning sort of telling the story about bringing the pieces together, the utilities' role working with affordable housing developers, working with other funders, and kind of the painting the whole picture, I think would be worth pursuing.
Similar to what I was going to say. So I think, no, that's fine. So the both examples that I gave were co-op boards. And the reason why I decided to do that, because co-op boards have interesting personalities and they are the most difficult people to get all to agree. But one uniqueness about the Retrofit Accelerator program is that we have the opportunity to educate the buildings about the opportunities. But at the same time, we're communicating with utilities and we're communicating with the state agencies that provide incentives about these buildings. So they are aware of what's happening. They are aware of their interests, and they are able to respond to that building's interests in a way that's flexible to maybe not the delay in the acceptance of doing a project.
Excellent. So if you have a question, you can go to the mic. Or maybe it'll be passed around.
Okay. Hi, so I have a question for Daphne about the, I know you mentioned that most of the work you had been getting was because of regulations that were in place. And I was just wondering if your company has plans for when regulations aren't in place, like if you have outreach plans for keeping this work going on.
Sure. So the regulations that I spoke about are city regulations, and the city actually has a greenhouse gas emission goal. So we do want to reduce our greenhouse gas emissions 80% by 2050. And so part of that initiative is trying to help these existing buildings become more efficient, because I believe it's like 75% of buildings will still exist in that year, in 2050. So we want to make sure that we provide that technical assistance. I do want to say, in the affordable housing side, a lot of the buildings, similar to the building that I highlighted in the Lower East Side, they don't have to comply with the legislation. So it's purely we go and we still speak to buildings about the opportunities, because as it's mentioned here, state funding, federal funding, even city funding might not be available tomorrow. So it's important for people to use that funding now that they can, and can help reduce the cost of these measures. And as it's been spoken, it's cheaper to do it together than do it separately and in the future.
Welcome. Hi, open to all of you. I would love to hear about your opinion. So two questions quickly. Usually all the statistics about energy burden are not gender specific, and women are the ones that are like holding like poverty around the country. So what do you think it can be done to target these groups specifically? And if you have any experience around this, like what could you like tell us about? And the second thing, as you mentioned, like I think awareness is really important. How, like what effective communication strategies will you put in place? Thank you.
That's such a great question, and you're right. I've seen this around the country in my work, that oftentimes, you know, women-headed households are disproportionately burdened. And so how do we address that? I mean, in the affordable multifamily space, the best way I've seen that addressed is to engage the women, have them sort of, I think you were discussing this, ask them, you know, what's going on in their life? You know, you don't sort of start the question with, can I come in and do a complete audit of your home while your child's asleep and you're trying to get to work? But, you know, it's about the trust factor. And so I think that's probably one of the reasons, too, when we talk about subscription rates to energy efficiency programs being so low. It's because we show up unannounced, some newcomer. But I think working in community through existing channels, where women oftentimes are already leaders of the housing group or leader of, you know, sort of the resident services work, or, you know, they understand their communities oftentimes. way better than, I mean, any outsider will ever understand. And so I think it's finding those women who are already champions in their communities, building those relationships, figuring out what else is going on in their life and how these energy programs might play a role.
I'll speak a moment on it, and I totally agree with that. And I think especially, you know, the finding the trusted people in the community and to the engagement piece and raising awareness. You know, utilities are often seen as the bad guy, and especially when we're talking about low-income people who may be behind on their utility bills. If you have somebody in a uniform knocking on the door, that's not necessarily well-received all the time. And so there have been successful programs using community groups or churches or other trusted organizations to try to get messaging out there. And then also the other thing we were talking before the panel, we do have to be very aware that one size does not fit all when it comes to awareness and sort of raising awareness. And so it's very important to tailor messaging and to tailor programs to specific communities' needs in order to I think, increase awareness and engagement.
And I would just add that a lot of times we think about what low-income families, for example, are unable to do. But there is a lot that people are doing to cope with the circumstances, and there's ingenuity and everyday experiences regarding energy conservation. There's so much to be learned. Yes, there are needs, but then there are also these like very positive coping strategies, which I think can also start to elevate not only the conversation, but the status of these women who are negotiating poverty in really creative ways. So, I mean, my work has also kind of suggested that there's a behavioral component and that there's a coping component that is super complex, and that if we understood it a little bit more, we can give credit to these women who are doing like really amazing things every day to cope with poverty.
Thank you.
I'll just add one thing. So I agree with all of that. I was going to literally take a minute. So we were actually talking about how there's not one solution for everything. And in the program, specifically in the affordable housing space, many times I find myself going to meetings at 8 p.m., 9 p.m. at night just to make sure that I can provide this information to these building owners. And many times they're monolingual. So I will have this whole conversation about energy efficiency in Spanglish because some of the words I don't even know how to say in Spanish. And it's really being able to give them the opportunity to be engaged and to understand that this is something that's not a foreign thing. It's actually theirs, and it's part of their culture, and it's something that will help them in the long term and build that trust. Because a lot of times when we speak about energy is a foreign concept when it's brought upon with the idea of utilities and incentives and financing, and you can close the door in that method. And what I've seen in my work at Retrofit Accelerator is really sitting down, taking the step back, understanding what are the issues. How, you know, they complain about not having gas, they complain about the banging steam pipes, and really taking that conversation and translating it to, okay, so let's see how we can try to fix that. And that's been very helpful to communicate.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
Hi, so first I just wanted to say thank you to everyone. This has been really interesting. I'm a primary care provider in the South Bronx, and most of what I've been hearing has been addressing building owners and people who have some degree of power in the community or to make these changes. And I am wondering if there are things being done for individuals to give people who are at the whims of their landlord, who's not taking care of many, many other things, to make these changes in their buildings, or what suggestions you have at that level.
Yeah, I mean, all of the energy efficiency for all work is with affordable multifamily buildings and the residents in those buildings, too. So the network that I describe that you all are able to participate in if you want by going to energyefficiencyforall.org, it's a network of energy and water, healthy, affordable building folks. And that's done at a local level. So that is reaching out in those aid states, but it's happening elsewhere too, to engage the residents themselves and to figure out, you know, how they're doing and what they need in their properties. So I don't know that really, that doesn't answer your question though, does it? Not at all.
So the retrofit accelerator is aware. We are primarily focused on building owners. And something that we have been speaking about now during this heating season is a better seen heat, right? So when buildings have to do heating improvements, it's people automatically think about their boilers. But the second component or the third component or the most important component for a lot of these affordable housing providers are their tenants. And so how do you raise awareness? How do you increase the opportunity to have the tenant trust a contractor to open the door and put a valve or open a door and put in a thermostat? You know, some people might think it's a monitoring system and they won't feel comfortable. So we stay tuned because we haven't formally announced any of our tenant engagement components of our program, but we are definitely thinking about it. And the city is aware that it's a critical component of energy efficiency because it is necessary to address the building systems holistically, but it is just as important to address the tenant space.
And I would add to that, that I'm listening to people, right? To people's stories. I mean, one of the things that I'm an academic and, you know, being in these spaces from an academic perspective, first of all, representation, like diversity in the energy space is lacking, to say the least. And so creating diversity pipelines that allow for, honestly, you know, people that look like me you know, to be in these spaces and creating the conversations, I think is important. But while we're here, wherever we are, right? So even you as a physician, the way that I learned about this was actually through a research project that was based in community health centers in Boston. So part of this is also about understanding and listening to people's problems. Because the easy thing is to say poverty is just about not having enough money. But when you really start to disentangle the issues of poverty, then you see that energy has its own kind of flavor, that food has its own flavor, that housing insecurity has its own flavor. And then the solutions can also be as colorful as the problems if we're just listening to what people are actually experiencing.
So I'll add quickly, because I'm sure we're almost out of time to that. But I think that in a lot of the literature, what you mentioned is often called a split incentive for, you know, renters. Basically, tenants want energy efficiency initiatives installed so they can have lower utility bills, but there's somebody else who has to pay for it, and so nothing gets done because the building owner may not have the incentive to invest in the building in that way. And it is a big issue, and one that I think there are a lot of us in this space are trying to find creative ways to address. But I'll also say, and this is kind of going back to the utility perspective again, but customer satisfaction matters to utilities. You know, consumer perspective matters. And so we'll have a lot of our members saying, hey, look, I need to figure out how to better engage my customers. And so they're kind of looking for ways that they can increase their customer satisfaction. And part of that is by listening. And so if we can offer tools that say, here's how you better connect with your customer, I think that there's some opportunity there. Now, it may not be as direct necessarily, but I think a lot of us are working in that space. And then the other that I would mention, and I've mentioned them before, but community action agencies. If we can work with those trusted organizations in communities, I think that there's an open channel there that we should work on partnerships.
Yeah, and just to add one more point to that. You're absolutely right. So community organizations have been instrumental to Retrofit Accelerator. They have been the ones that have been going out, speaking to tenants, from the tenants, talking to the landlords and the property manager about the opportunity of energy efficiency. And we've seen that, especially in the HCFC realm in New York City, and it's been very instrumental to get the word out. So in that way, we've seen a lot of work and value in the community organization space.
Any other questions? If not, let's please join me in thanking the panelists for this wonderful event.